Thank you. I'm Damon. I'm with Ellingson Companies out of southern Minnesota. We're a construction company, so we don't actually own any utilities, but we pride ourselves in taking advantage of the latest technologies for all underground pipe projects that we work on in several different sectors. Today we're going to focus on the gas utility distribution sector. So today we're going to start by kind of talking about what was the challenge to overcome to begin with, why change what we're doing. And what I'm going to be talking to you about is how we changed our documentation when we put new installation into the ground. We're going to learn a little bit about tracking, traceability, and utility pipeline data model. Probably all experts on it, but without a little bit of briefing on that, a lot of this doesn't make sense. And then we're going to get into what it actually took to put all the cool pieces of GIS together to build the workflow. And lastly, I'll go over some of the results from some of our first projects, talk about some lessons learned and some things that we're hoping to improve upon going forward. So if it's not broke, why fix it? That's what every crew member is going to tell me, all right? We've been putting pipe in the ground for generations and decades. We send the client a bill. The bill sends us a payment. People in their houses get heat in the winter. What's the problem, right? Well, it's twofold. One, a few years back, I had a salesman who went to a meeting with a utility company and came back and said, guess what, Damon? They're going to pay us to put pipe in the ground, and they want you to do your GIS stuff. Can you digitally map it live in the field? Sure, never done it before, we'll figure it out, right? That's where the fun is. The second problem is that utility hits is a really big deal. Every year, year after year, there's more of them being done because people don't really know where things are, right? In 2019 in Minnesota, where I'm from, there's over 4,000 hits, of which about half of them involved gas. So not only are we trying to look for efficiencies on coming in at budget or under, times and delays, but it's the safety aspect, knowing that future projects going forward that everybody's going to get to go home. There's got to be a better way, right? I mean, right now, this is how we know where things are, right? We call a guy, he comes out with a can of spray paint. Hopefully, it's not white in the winter. They switch to pink. And if our operator knows Morse code and a little bit of luck, he can sometimes figure out where the utilities may or may not be. So, working with the utility companies, I wanted to incorporate a digital as-building capability that was going to satisfy our need for how we do things in our other divisions, but also their needs. And they told me something about this utility data model network that I had not been familiar with at the time, and a utility pipeline, you know, feature layer set. So, did a little Googling, and by coincidental dumb luck, I found a guy named Tom DeWitt, who works with Esri. And I emailed him and said, Tom, you seem to know about this utility pipeline data model. What can you tell me? And he emailed me back. He said, wouldn't you know it, I'm only about an hour from your office. Why don't you come on up? I've been working on a white paper for tracking and traceability. And so what I learned was that in 2015, the Pipeline Hazardous Material Safety Commission got together and proposed some new rules to address the need for operators to better track the details and location of assets after their delivery from the manufacturer. And the rule also spoke for the need to better traceability of assets, meaning the ability to locate them by material, diameter, lot number, manufacturer dates, and other attributes. And so with that, we decided to use utility data model. And what it is, if you guys aren't familiar with it, it's a feature data set with a bunch of layers. And these layers have attribute table that are miles and miles long. It's a one size fits all. So when we work with our clients, we don't intend to use every single one, but we work with them to identify which ones they need to track for their operations and their system. And we get that list down, and then we work on setting up a schema for default values, you know, project numbers, right, dates, things like that, and then also pick lists. You know, the goal is to get the best data integrity possible so that there's less human errors, and take the human out of the equation whenever possible. One of the ways that this is happening is that part of this 2015 revelation of a better way to do it was that the ASTM standard created a 16-digit alphanumeric cap-sensitive barcode,
that all the plastic component pipe manufacturers are going to use that when parsed properly can give you wall thickness, diameter, lot number, manufacture date, about 7 attributes in total that our guys would have to write on a piece of paper normally, and someone at some point would have to actually try to read what they wrote. So by using scanners on just our simple iPads and phones,
we're able to scan barcodes that will then use the attribute rules from this database that I forgot to mention needs to be set up in an enterprise geo database. And I say that like it's nothing, but for a lot of GIS teams, that's not a nothing. Enterprise geo databases don't magically create themselves. And if you're not used to using them, there's a learning curve on that itself. And there's probably classes in this conference where you could spend the whole class learning about how to manage and set up those. Really, everything I'm about to tell you is impossible to squeeze into 15 minutes. So if you have follow-up questions, let me know. But we're going to cover a lot of ground here. So as we're creating this new wheel, right, this new way we're going to try to create data versus pen and paper, and we need to make sure Butch can figure it out, we incorporated field maps at the time collector, survey 1, 2, 3, and then we need to make sure that not only was our data accurate, but that the position was accurate. Right? It goes back to that tracing and checkability, so that when we do a query, when we figure out that lot number 77 that was manufactured on July 25th needs to be dug up, our backhoe can go and find it on the first try. And so for that, we use GNSS receivers through Eos. We use their Arrow Gold unit, which is a centimeter grade accuracy locating device. And for shooting in the water meters, the gas meters, they're a little trickier, right? They're typically under trees, under the eave of a roof, next to a two-story building. And so you have to shoot them with offsets, and there's a laser that can attach to your pole, and you can shoot your point in the middle of the street, get your accuracy, move over, shoot the laser at the gas meter, move over, shoot your point, shoot the laser, and it triangulates it so that you can still maintain that accuracy level that you would do even if you're standing right next to the building. Not talking to satellites. There's a lot of trial and error and learning on how to best go shoot points if that's not something you're used to doing. With field maps then, our guys would simply press the plus button, right? And they'd say, I am going to drop an excess flow valve right here, a meter riser, a T, a MetFit coupler. They go through the predefined pick list that we set up, and they'd enter maybe on any given project only by hand 5 or 10 different fields at most, but then they'd scan that barcode. And we'll talk about barcodes later in lessons learned. Don't take it for granted how easy it is to scan a barcode. And that'll auto-populate another 7 attribute fields, right? And they're using, with the EOS unit, we're tapping into RTK networks. So in Minnesota, we're fortunate. We have a free one with Minn Coors. Some of the other surrounding states have free ones. We also do projects out like in the Black Hills, where there's not an RTK network. EOS has a service called Atlas that you can, it's a monthly subscription fee. But with that one, you can maintain approximately 4 to 6 inches of accuracy without a true RTK network using their Atlas satellite constellation. So in the middle of the mountains, 6 inches is pretty darn good. It's within a bucket scoop. And then after the crew goes in and shoots all their services, we have, and within the feature itself, we've configured the pop-up to have a link to open up a survey, survey 1, 2, 3, which then the foreman can click on to put in his inspection notes and other information that I don't always fully understand, but I know is important to the project, that isn't as simple as shoot and click. And with all that data being captured like that, we can create really awesome dashboards and web apps that essentially live from the field, assuming they have online capabilities and we didn't have to build it for offline, will come right back to the office. And not only our office, but if the utility network division that we're working with has a GIS team with their own portal or online capabilities, we'll set up a collaboration with them so that when this data is getting entered in the field, it's actually going into layers that are shared between divisions. So when the service on 10th Street at 10 a.m. in the morning goes active, the utility department knows about it at 10 a.m. in the morning, not 10 a.m. in the morning 3 months from now as guys are scrounging up pieces of paper to turn in at the end of the project. It's a big deal. But cool dashboards are not always enough. Undoubtedly, every utility company that I've worked with so far has somebody who really likes paper. And nothing makes them feel more happy than going to the printer and picking up that piece of paper, sniffing it, walking to the filing cabinet, putting it in there never to be seen again, and resting assured that it was done good. So to overcome that, we had to come up with some creative solutions. We tried a handful of things, and what we settled on was creating a Word doc template of the customer's format, and every customer has different formats of their letterhead and however else they want to do it. And then using dynamic text with syntax in Arc Pro, it can grab the data from all the different layers that were being populated from the crew in real time and actually start filling in this PDF and having the map center on where the specific service asset is. And then with a little bit of black magic, we can then export it out as a PDF and attach it to the service feature. So now the guy who needs that PDF can click on every single service in real time as it's being populated, and if he chooses, print a piece of paper and put it in his filing cabinet. We were going to use Survey 123 to do the reporting thing, but we ran into limitations with how good we could get the map to look, and also limitations on grabbing data from multiple different layers and bringing them together into one report that, you know, maybe not all that was in the single survey. So the results is a really cool, shiny new tire, right? I gotta read this one, sorry guys, but you know, we had roughly 2,400 features on this project that we shot in with our GNSS receivers with the Arrow Gold. We averaged a quarter inch accuracy throughout the entire project. We did spot checks, with other survey equipment and with the city's, you know, survey team to confirm that, you know, that we were good. We used RTK networks. We had, 23,000 or so attributes, not counting the 36,000, auto-populated GPS attributes by simply checking the enable metadata for GPS box when you create a layer. All these attributes, over 1,000 of them were these 16-digit cap-sensitive alphanumeric ones, right? And just, I know you guys can't read, and I'm sorry you're going to lose me. But on these reports, you're going to see riser leg, riser lug, septic couplings, pipe, cap. Every single component has one of these 16-digit numbers, and you can actually read them. And no one wrote them down. We took the human part out of it, right? And that's a big deal, because at the end of the project, then we got almost 17,000 digits with no human entry other than pressing the button on the barcode scanner, which means zero data errors. And maybe the coolest part about this new workflow is that at the end of the project, when the guys left the job site after putting their last piece into the ground, they walked away and we were done. I call the utility company and say, we're done. They say, great, looks like we have all your data. Hope to do work with you next time. I don't know about you guys, but this is a big deal, right? Like, I've heard rumors in the past, prior to this workflow, occasionally these pieces of paper that they fill out in the field would end up in glove departments, the dog would eat a few of them, they'd misplace them, and months after the project, after the customer would pester us enough, guys might go into a room and try to retrofill all kinds of paperwork on where the assets are and what they put in the ground and all these different specs. And they were spot on after 3 months and five projects ago. Their memory is like a steel vault. This is a big deal. So lessons learned. As we implemented this, it was not without its challenges. It seemed like every step we built, we had to overcome something. I have a spot on my wall that says, bang your head here. It's why I'm bald. But after so much banging, you break through, and then it's like the rush of, success. But the real big keys is support from leadership. As GIS professionals, we can't be the bad cop. We have to be the good cop. We got to be the people that go to the job site with the pizza just to make sure everything's working well. But we have to have the leadership to enforce it and to make sure that they're promoting it to be used, because it is a culture change. And I do got guys on my crew named Butch with hands like stone claws who break 3 iPads a week because, you know, they're not good at pressing buttons. Training is not a one-time, you know, come to my class and maybe you show up, maybe you don't. It's a continuous thing until it becomes the new norm. Until it becomes where the guys on the crew get used to it and understand that they like going to the hotel at the end of the day and not having any paperwork to do because they already did it live in the field. So where now they're asking for this on their projects and don't want to go back. After they understand that not collecting data isn't an option. The option is, do you want to go with paper or do you want to go digital? We're telling you need to go digital, but not collecting isn't an option. And once you get that through their head, then they realize that they actually like whipping out their phone, pressing a few numbers, better than they like doing paperwork in the hotel. Scanning barcodes, like I said, sounds simple enough. I have demoed out cheap barcode scanners and multi-$1,000 barcode scanners. When the Mylar bag has a printing error from the manufacturer, it doesn't matter what kind of scanner you have, it will not scan it. Yellow plastic pipe with nice fancy barcodes, they get wiped off with your thumb or dirt or mud. And the mud on job sites, for any of you who haven't been to job sites, is like peanut butter. I mean, it is thick. I helped develop this workflow in the very beginning and was out there every day, and I had to spend about 15 minutes after every shift with a stick in my boots cleaning the mud out of the bottom of my boots before I get in my car. So what we came up with was I went old school. I said, keep it simple, stupid, right? I got key rings, and I did an inventory assessment at the utilities warehouse before the project started. I took pictures of all the different components that were going to be part of the project and got all the barcodes off of them. And I made my own barcodes onto like flashcards that were color-coded by the different asset types. So if there was a fitting or a T or a service main. And then I put them on a key ring and laminated them. So that way, twofold, right? The barcode worked and it scanned. But they also didn't have to, when they're shooting that point like this, because trying to get the rod right over top of the T and the hole is like this big, right? They don't have to get down in the bottom and try to get that sticker as they scan it. They just flip to their thing and they scan their barcode and life goes on. It's not perfect, but it actually works pretty good. And then the cost, you know, nothing's free, right? So sometimes we can do a project where I have a foreman who got a really good head on his shoulders or his shoulders and they can go through this without any help. Other projects, Butch needs a friend. He needs a college intern to help with this data collection and go pick up things at Home Depot when they're missing. And there's the cost of, you know, us setting up the project and maintaining it. And so some of these bids that go out for gas distribution work are really, really competitive, and the customers aren't quite on board yet, but I think it's going to be changing soon that, you know, this is something worth paying for. It's not just the value added now, it's the value added on every project going forward when they know within a quarter inch accuracy where the excess flow valve is. And then I'll leave you guys with this. This is a wise man gave me this saying, but I couldn't agree with it more. All things are difficult before they're easy. And this couldn't have been truer. This is a super fun workflow now that we enjoy doing. But right out of the gate, it was there was a lot of headbanging. So. And that's where we leave it. Thank you.